Hello dear children, in the last lecture we have discussed the poem Life, and in that we have seen the word meanings, the about the poetess, about the meaning or explanation of the poem. Today we will see the grammar part of the poem. So let us begin. So if you see the poem, especially the last part, last words of the of each line, the first word, the end of the first word is dream. The second word says say, third rain, and fourth day. Now children, here we are going to see the rhyme scheme of the poem. So the first line ends in dream, we call it as A. The second line ends with the word say. So dream and say do not rhyme with each other. So we call this say as B. Dream does not rhyme with say, neither does it rhyme with rain. So we will leave, and dream does not even rhyme with day. So it does not rhyme with any of the other ending words where the line ends, the last word of the line in the entire stanza. So now we will consider the second word, which is say. So we will see whether say rhymes with rain. No, it doesn't. And rain does not rhyme with any of the last word of the line. So we will call it as see. Now say rhymes with day. So we will write it as B. So the rhyme scheme of the first stanza is A, B, C, B. Okay. This is how we find out the rhyme scheme of the poem. So let us now move ahead to the second stanza so that the concept of rhyme scheme is very clear. Now in the second stanza we see the first word is gloom. Now till above we have seen that the rhyme scheme was A, B, C, B. So if we are considering the entire poem, we will continue with the alphabets. So it will be A, B, C, B. So we have completed up to C, this will be D. Gloom, all do not rhyme, so it will be E. Gloom, bloom does rhyme, so it will be D again. And all and full also rhyme, so it will be D, E, D, E. Okay, so the rhyme scheme of the first stanza was A, B, C, B. The second stanza was D, E, D, E. I hope the concept of rhyme scheme is quite clear. And similarly, we can find out the rhyme scheme of the remaining stanzas as well. Now moving ahead, let us see what are the poetic devices used in this poem. So let us see in the first four lines what do we have. Oft a little morning rain foretells a pleasant day. So from here to here, it is a metaphor, because the morning rains are compared implicitly to the rain difficulties of our life, and the pleasant day is implicitly compared to the joyous times of our life. Then sometimes there are clouds of gloom. So these clouds are the difficulties in our life, so problems in our life. So these are also implicitly compared, and therefore this is also an example of metaphor. Then if the showers will make the roses gloom,
here the problems are compared to the rains or the shower, and better times are compared to the blooming of the roses. So here again it is a metaphor. Oh, why lament its fall? This is with a question mark. So this is a figure of speech interrogation. Then moving ahead, rapidly, merrily, life's sunny hours flit by. Life's sunny hour flits by. Here, a life sunny hours flit by is also an example of metaphor, because sunny hours is the happy or joyous times of our life. Those are compared to the sunny hours. Now, gratefully, cheerily enjoy them as they fly. Okay, fine. Now, in this next stanza or next lines, we can see, what though death time at times steps in and calls our best away. Again, this is an example of interrogation. The question is asked, what though sorrow seems to win over hope a heavy sway. Again, an interrogation, a question is asked. And here also we have the examples of personification, like what though death at times steps in. Here the human quality of stepping in is given to death, so it is a personification as well. Then, and calls our best away, sorrow seems. Okay, and here, sorrow seems to win. Again, sorrow, an imaginary thing or a non-tangible thing, is given the attribute or is given the quality of human quality. Again, it is a personification. And then, yet hope again elastic springs. So again, hope is given the quality of elastic spring. Okay, so here we were seeing that yet hope again unconquered though she fell. This is the figure of speech of personification, because hope is given the quality of being unconquered, just like human quality. Then also in the last line, can courage quell despair. So quell despair is end unhappiness. So courage is given the quality, human quality of ending unhappiness, which is again a figure of speech personification. A human quality is given. So this is all we can see in the poem. Then now we are going to move ahead and see in more details about the figures of speech. And for that, I have a video for you and an audio visual, so that you can understand it still better. Okay, so let us move forward. Dear children, today we will learn about figurative versus literal meaning of words in English. It is also called as figurative language and literal language. This is the introduction to the figures. As we know that we should have strong roots to have strong, to have good fruits. So let's begin. The The words used in English have two meanings. First is literal, which means that what is said is meant by. In simple words, it means we go by the dictionary meaning of the words, whereas figurative means drawing the mental picture of whatever is being said so that it will help convey the idea faster and more vividly. So the literal gives us the dictionary meaning of the words, whereas the figurative helps us to imagine whatever is being said. Let us see an example. Bolt ran very fast in the race. Here we get to know that Bolt ran really very fast in the race. As we go by the literal meaning, that is the dictionary meaning. But when we say Bolt ran like a cheetah in the race, a picture of Bolt and cheetah running, our mind starts imagining the picture of cheetah and Bolt running, and we start comparing Bolt and cheetah. So here what happens is we understand better, as our mind is made in such a way that it recognizes pictures easily, and therefore it is rightly said that a picture is worth a thousand words. So now, children, you must be very clear with the literal and figurative meanings, figurative language. Let us see a few more examples. A briefcase weighs a lot. Let us now see how we can say the same sentence in a figurative language. The briefcase weighs a ton. Here the briefcase does not really weigh a ton, but it is exaggerated for better understanding. Next example, his mind is very cool. In figurative language, we can write this as his mind is as cool as a cucumber. Here we are comparing his mind to a cucumber to make the readers understand more clearly. Now, when we should use the literal language and when should we use the figurative language? Literal language is used while writing a highly technical stuff, and use figurative language when you want to make your work more interesting or dramatic, like that in a story, a drama, a play, or a poem.